You have been tasked with a very important job, and that is to select this material set for making thin film solar cells. So you have been asked to, go figure out what materials would be the optimum materials for the manufacturing of these thin film solar cells. And furthermore, at this point, you're not supposed to worry about technological issues such as processing, defects, things like that. You're assuming that you can hire a team of PhDs in material science and electrical engineering to figure that out for you. Right now, you just want to look at all the materials which are available in nature and figure out what would be the best for, making these thin film solar cells. So I want to give you a set of guidelines or, at least a few things you should look for while choosing the right materials for making these thin film solar cells. So a first starting point, a good place to start is to look at the absorption coefficient of different materials. So I'm taking this slide over here where I've plotted out these absorption coefficient for a variety of semiconductor materials such as gallium arsenide, germanium, silicon, cadmium telluride, cadmium sulfide, amorphous silicon. So you see that the absorption coefficient, they vary over a large range, and they all seem to be very high for low wavelength or for photons which have high frequency. But what I should probably look for is how's the absorption coefficient very close to the tail, or how steep is the absorption coefficient near the band gap of the material. So for example, the band gap of cadmium sulfide, this material over here, is somewhere around 2.1 eV. Or the band gap of cadmium telluride, it is somewhere close to 1.12 eV. So I see that my absorption coefficient is very, very high, or it's rising very quickly, at least near the band gap, and that's a good sign. So having a high absorption coefficient, essentially what it corresponds to is that if you have a high absorption coefficient, that means a lot of, and especially if you have high absorption coefficient near the band gap, that means you can absorb most of your light in a very short distance. And that would give, that would give you the ability to use less amount of material and make your solar cell using a very thin film of this absorber material. So that's the reason why absorption coefficient is important. And I'm showing in this chart over here, this is the absorption coefficient for the function of energy in this case. And it's plotted for these, these common suspects, the materials which are used for making thin film solar cells, such as amorphous silicon, these two organic materials which are used for making organic cells, then cadmium telluride, SiGs. And you see that all of them have very, they have high absorption coefficient. So absorption coefficient of 10 to power 5 per centimeter would mean that you would require, one divided by that, or you'll require, you'll require essentially 10 micron of material. So, this would be centimeter minus, so it would be around 10 micron of the material to absorb, a lot of this light which lies at this correspondingly photon energy. So a high absorption coefficient, essentially it leads to less amount of the material required. And that is clearly seen in this other chart over here as well. So you see that if you use, so this is plotting the short circuit current as a function of a thickness of my solar cell. So I'm making the solar cell, but I'm varying the thickness. And you see that materials which are strong absorbers, such as this red curve over here, which corresponds to this red curve, which corresponds to SiGs, or this green curve over here, which corresponds to CadTel. So you see that the short circuit current, it rises initially as a function of thickness, but it saturates very quickly. So, if I have 1 micron of this material, it's sufficient to absorb most of the light, or the most of the light which I can extract in the form of electrons and holes, which contribute to, which contributes to the short circuit current anyway. And you see that using a very thin amount of this material, I can make a good solar cell. In the case of SiGs, I can achieve very high short circuit current using a very thin film of this material. Versus if I compare it to the case of say nanocrystalline silicon, you see that over here this essentially this short circuit current is continually it's continuing to increase all the way to up to more than 10 microns. So typically the range we want to operate in is around this 1 micron range, or maximum around 2 or 3 or 5 micron of material. And so the first thing to look at is essentially absorption coefficient and how steeply it rises near the band gap of this material. The other criteria, other guideline which should you should keep in mind is the band gap of your material. So shown here is the maximum efficiency possible as a function of band gap. So this is what is called as a Shockley-Quasier graph of efficiency. And you see that this has a broad optimum. So the efficiency, it can reach all the way up to it can reach all the way up to 32 to 35% in an ideal world. In an ideal world where there are no defect centers, there are no grain boundaries for these thin film materials, if you assume just an ideal case, these efficiencies can reach up to lower 30s, but your band gap in which it happens is a broad peak around this all the way from 1.1 to around 1.5 or 1.6 electron volt. So you should choose your material such that your band gap of this material, it lies close to this optimum value. So shown over here is that essentially if you have your CadTel material or your CIGS material. In CIGS material, in CadTel for example, it has a band gap of around 1.4, and that's very nice. For the CIGS material, you can tune the band gap all the way from 1.1 to all the way up to 1.5 or 1.6, depending upon what percentage of gallium you add. So if you have no gallium, you just have a CIS cell, then your band gap would be around 1.1. If you have a complete 100% gallium and no indium, then your band gap would be high. So you can tune this band gap within this range for the CIGS material. The other material, the CZTS, which essentially replaces the indium and gallium by this zinc and tin, which are more readily available, and we'll talk about that just now. It also has this optimum band gap. Why some of these other materials, for example amorphous silicon, it lies somewhere over here. So its band gap is not the optimum, but still okay in terms of efficiency. If you go even further up, so if you consider materials such as cadmium sulfide or zinc oxide, their band gaps are way too high to give you a high efficiency. So if you choose a material like zinc oxide, it has a very high band gap. So a lot of your photons, all your photons which corresponds to energy less than the band gap of this material will essentially just pass by this material without getting converted into electron and hole. So choosing this optimum band gap is again very important. The third and the final criteria which I would recommend for choosing this material is look at what is the availability. So what is the availability of these materials in the crust of the earth, and how easily can they be extracted? For example, cadmium telluride is very pervasively very actively used for making these thin film solar cells. But if you look over here, beryllium is one of the rarest available material in the crust of the earth. So of course that is not a good sign. Similarly for CIGS bait cell, these I over here, it stands for indium. And again you see that indium is it's starting to appear in red over here, where it has again very low concentration present in the crust of the earth. Then another thing you should look at is, what is the availability of, or how, what is the availability of buying these materials from a market? For example, or what is the production capacity of these materials? For example, things like copper, they are readily mined for other industries as well, such as, construction and making pots and pans. So there's a large amount of availability of these materials. Versus if you, let's say, consider silicon, it's also available for making other chips and other things that are made with the silicon. But again, this was something that people miscalculated. Even for silicon, there was a big scarcity of silicon around 2007 to 2010 range, because suddenly the demand for solar went so high that there was not enough production capacity. So it's important to take these things into account as well, and that is especially true for pterillium, which has a production of of only around 220 tons per year, and a large fraction of that is currently being used for making these cattle-based solar cell. So these are some of the other things you should keep into mind. Keep